Hey, everybody, and welcome to the Charles Matthews Show. We're doing a special series. It's called My Brothers. I'm bringing different men to the show so you can hear the voices first. Get to know them. You know how they say never judge a book by its cover? We are just going to find out a little bit more about each guest before we dive in. So let's welcome my guests, Michael, to the show. Michael, are you there?
Hey, yes, I'm here, Charles. Thank you for having me.
Welcome to the show, my friend. How you doing?
I'm doing well, Just enjoying the, like I said, warmer weather. So it's good.
Well, thank you for being my guest on the show. And then, you know, we worked on a couple of projects that we just passed. And I'm like, you know, me really getting to know you, I found out a lot of things about you, about, you know, where you come from, your personality. And I thought you'd be a great guest for other people to get to know you a little bit more. So before we dive into us, tell us who you are. Give us some background on you.
Well, Charles, thank you for having me on the show. It's my privilege to be here. As you said, my name is Michael Farquharson. I'm originally from Jamaica, born and raised in Jamaica. My wife and I actually immigrated here about 16 years ago. You know, we've been married now for 21 years. We have three children, you know, 17, 11, and 4, so quite a spread there. And, you know, I like being in my community. I like helping out in my community, and that's my passion. My passion is to help whoever I can help. You know, I grew up in Jamaica, you know, in a poor community, and people are always helping, you know, from different, you know, ethnic groups, from different generations. And so part of me growing up in Jamaica was that it was a community that raised me. You know, the other part is that my father died when I was a baby, and my mother actually died when I was 16. So I was an orphan at 16, and so I was raised by one of my uncles. I have two younger brothers. We were separated, and so as a family, they came together and raised us as brothers and with a wider community. So my passion is always to give back to the community. So that's kind of my background, Charles.
Well, let's dive into that, because that is something that I didn't even know that your parents passed away so young. What you told me, you were what, 16, you said?
Yes, yes. And my mom died, and that made me an orphan at that time, yes.
Right. So you have no brothers and sisters?
Yeah, I have two younger brothers. The first one is about 7 years younger than I am. Then the next one is about 11 years younger.
So you as a young man really had to step up to the plate real quick.
Oh, yes. I had to learn life's lessons from an early age, actually. One thing in Jamaica is that, you know, when you grow up poor, you're, I would say, encouraged or kind of forced to do other things to kind of, you know, allow you to mature earlier than most kids. You know, at 10 years old, actually, I had a part-time job, you know, to earn some extra income for my family. So that forced me to kind of take the lead in my family. My two younger brothers, you know, kind of follow my stead in terms of looking up to me, and I was kind of the male role model in their life. So it forced me to take a leadership role from early. So that's part of what my experience has taught me today, to be a leader.
Wow, and that's something that a lot of people can look into. So growing up as a young kid, what did you learn? Like, because you came here at what age?
Actually, we came here when I was about 29. We immigrated here to Canada. But from a young age, as I said, I've learned the value of community, the value of hard work, the value of always giving your best. And so, you know, it takes a lot of sacrifices to do that. And I said, you know, the community that raised me, from my uncle, my aunts, my grandmom, you know, taking turns at different times to raise me until I was an adult, that really played a lot into my development. And, you know, being a part of my community now that I live in Brampton, that has, you know, equipped me to be out there to say, you know, this is my experience growing up as a youth, you know, being involved in my community, getting assistance from different people in my community. So that has really developed me into the person I am today.
So you have three girls, you said?
Two girls, 17 and 11, and one boy, 4 years old.
Okay, so here's the thing. we all know, I have kids of my own. We know girls and guys growing up, when you come to first father, can you, because I don't want to go too much in this direction with you, but because you're like a young man and you had kids of your own, tell us how that felt.
Well, you know, Charles, you know, I would say the greatest gift in life is to be a father, to be a parent. And I remember my first child, first girl, you know, I'm like, you know, when we had her, I'm like, oh, Lord, I'm not responsible for another life. You know, I know we marked your wife, you know, but, you know, she's an adult, you know, she does her own stuff. But here you have a life, a new life came into the world, and you're totally responsible. So I took on that pressure, that burden, and say, I got to make sure that I, you know, provide for her, you know, and it's a girl. But, you know, being I would call a girl's dad, that's totally different, because as a boy growing up, you know, you never quite understand girls. But here I am, I'm a girl, I'm like, okay, things are different, you know, I gotta learn to take care of a girl, you know, from changing diapers to waking up late at night to feeding her, giving my wife a rest. And so you know, that time has always been priceless in my eyes, but it has changed my life completely. And as I said, being responsible for another life, another human being, I'm like, this is serious stuff. Like, I can't mess up.
So then you had another girl.
Then we had another girl. And, you know, she was born when her first child was 11, 6, actually.
Yeah.
And I have another girl. I'm like, Lord, did I do something wrong? That was my first thing. You know, two girls, you know, and I'm like, you know what? I think I got this. I said to my wife, we got this. You know what? We had the first girl. She's doing well. And here's the second girl. We got this. And kind of the pressure kind of eased a bit. And the second girl, so, you know, we raised the first one. She was 6. She was going to grade 1 at a time. And we're like, yeah, we got this. But at the same time, no, we got to, you know, provide for 4 of us, not the 3. And so, you know, we had to do some things differently. One of the things that we did, I actually started working at night so that, you know, my wife and I kind of split the responsibility. And that second child actually didn't go to a daycare at all. So one of us were always there with her and both of them. So, you know, we changed a bit of life, but I'm like, Lord, two girls, I probably did something wrong, but you know what? I love them and I wouldn't give it up for the world.
Okay. And then here it is. Cause you know, we're men and men women don't understand this, but you know, when you're a man and then you have your boy, your whole world changes again. We love our daughters, but tell us how right. That felt to have your son.
Oh, yes. Our son, I mean, I think because we went through the first two, and we did ultrasound, trying to figure out the sex and learn the sex. And the third one, we're like, I'm not going to try doing ultrasound to figure out the sex. We're just going to let it be. You know, if we have a girl, and Lord, that's good. If we have a boy, that's, to me, I'm like, oh, you know, finally get my son. But we didn't do any ultrasound for the third one. And then to find out the sex, that is. But, you know, you go and do your periodical checkup, my wife and I did. And then the technician, we did tell her that, hey, we don't want to find out the sex. But she was so excited, she blurted out, it's a boy. And I'm like, thank you, Lord, you know, I got a boy, my son, I can, you know, train him up to be like me, you know. So that was exciting. And, you know, I was happy, I was ecstatic. I'm like, finally, I got a boy. And my wife is like, well, that's good that you got a boy. And, you know, I think I'm complete here. We're complete here having children. I'm like, yeah, I have no problem. No more. It's fine with me. So, you know, it was exciting, ecstatic at the time. So, as I said, it's different when you have a boy, you know, as a man. It changes your perspective too, because now you got to show him how to raise him up to be a man. And so with the girls, I always tell my wife, you know, you're a lady, you're going to train him up to be a lady. And then I train them from the perspective of all men look at girls and at women, so I can instill in them, you know, what to expect and some of the things that they should not put up with a boy. You know, I'm going to train him out to be a man. I'm going to train him to handle the tools or to fix up things and, you know, do things that men do, play golf, go bike riding together, so things like that. So it was exciting, and I'm still enjoying it. All three, of course, but he's a little bit different. I must admit, sometimes I pay more attention because I, society, I got to make sure that he knows his place as a man and he has to live as a man.
So here's the thing. Let's talk about, what is Michael different when he's with his girls? What does Michael do? Does Michael play, did you play house with your girls? Did you play, tell us something that people wouldn't recognize and know when they look at you that you do with your little girls.
Well, little girls, I tell you, Charles, I played house, I played everything, dress up, a tea party. I remember my first daughter, she, bought a tea set, and they're all pink, and she's in her little pink flirty dress, and I had to put on some pink stuff too. I'm like, oh wow. So you have to do all of those. I'm like, oh well, I guess this is what being a girl's dad is all about. And I look back at it, and I'm like, the second one was different, but I look back on the first one, I'm like, you know what? That was a different perspective, and that was what she wanted, was just for me to be there as her dad, to show and support and encourage her in whatever she does. The second one was different. She wasn't a girly girl, so to speak. She was more a rough girl. She wanted to be out there. She wanted me to, show her to do martial arts. She loves sports. She, plays basketball, and so she's rough going. You look at her, and people say, "You see me right there," but she's rough. She wants to wrestle. She wants to do martial arts. She told me that she wanted to be a spy when she grows up. She wanted to go on top of buildings. But I'm like, so the two of them were completely opposite in terms of what they want me to do or the support that they want from me. But the first one, in terms of being a girl's dad, that was quite different, and I enjoyed the experience. I probably. I said, well, at this time we probably won't be doing that anymore because they don't want to play else anymore. But
So how did,
I love that.
so let's take that as a family man. Is that why you went for like former city council or candidate? Do you is this why your passion is with the community? I see that you're doing a lot of things out there for families and community. Is this where it came from?
Yes, it came from my upbringing, in my community, and now, as a father, as a husband and a father, in my community and our children, I took up the challenge actually to run to city council when a number of friends approached me and said, we think you are the right person to represent, our city, represent the black community in the area. And just to go back, I was the only black candidate, so to speak, the not only that actually took part in my area out of 7 men. And I came in runner up, disappointed on that part, but it's good that we're out there and doing what we're doing to show that we care. And but it's basically from a family point of view, being family oriented. And I want the same for everyone, and especially in the black community, to know that, you know what, we don't have to stand aside and watch things happen. We need to be a part of it, need to be engaged in it, and do our part, because we have a generation that's coming up behind us that are looking, to us for leadership, to us for mentorship. And as you talk about it, Charles, my daughter actually was one of my campaign coordinators. She was the one organizing her classmates, booking interviews, booking debates and stuff like that. So that actually was the part that made me cry a little bit. I'm like, here's my daughter. She's actually taking notice. She's actually doing something. She's actually helping out. And when I see that, I'm like, the future is looking great because we have youth that are coming up behind us that are seeing what we're doing, and they're getting involved. So yes, it was because of my family and because of other families in the communities that say, we need a voice out there, we need representation. And so I took up that challenge. I'm one that likes challenges, Charles. From whatever projects are being done, I'm involved in it, and that's what I like.
See, the thing is, because we always see you on the trail, we see you marching, we see you at the community stuff, we see you doing that stuff, but it takes a lot for you to dive into it. So what's the one thing that people don't know about you, why you're so passionate about it?
Also, the one thing that people don't know about me, Charles, is that I am driven in the sense that I'm driven because I want our community to succeed, our community to elevate herself, both from a socioeconomic level and also from a participation level. So I'm driven, and whatever I do, the big picture behind that is to say that we are here, we're going to be represented, and we're going to we want to be at the table, and we need to be at the table. We're fighting to be at the table to show that we're here. We're not just, you know, watching things go by and just taking things easy, but we're here and we're making sure that changes that are happening in our community, that if they're for us, then we need to be a part of it. So no changes without us being there. And so I'm driven for that, Charles, to make sure that as a group, as blacks, that we are not just here watching things happen. We have a say, and we make sure the changes that are taking place are effective, and they would to make sure our community is better off in the long run.
So here it is. We know that you do all this work, and it's a great thing. You know, if you want to know more about what he does, you'll see that his link, his Instagram link, is in the description. You can see all the great thing he does. But let's go back a little bit. What do you do off time? What is your off time when you're not doing the community work, when you're not being city, you know, going for city councilor and stuff? What does Michael do? What do you do to relax?
That's a good question, Charles. A number of things. One of my passion is playing soccer and watching soccer. So I like to start the morning, just to get up at 10 a.m. and just watch soccer for a couple hours. I used to play in high school and in college, and I coached for a number of years, about 20 years. So that's one of my main passions. The other thing is that I like to cook. And so in my household, my wife, she takes a break from the cooking on the weekend. So, I like to cook. It's kind of relaxing. And, I like to throw up a jerk chicken here, some curry goat there, some oxtail here. You know, my son loves when I, do fried dumplings and ackee and saltfish. So, soccer and cooking. The other thing, too, I like to be outside in the environment and in nature. So when I do, I used to go camping a lot in Jamaica when I was actually in the cadet. I was a cadet sergeant. So just being outside in nature, I like to be outside, whether it's cutting my lawn, watering the lawn. Some people say that that's nothing, but you know what? It's relaxing. It's kind of bring down the stress level quite a bit. And so those are my three main areas that I do. And of course, just being with my family, spending time with them. We may not have nothing to do, Charles, but just being there, just talking, whatever comes to mind, having those family discussions, those are things that I look forward to in my downtime.
So let's touch back on a couple of things. You said you played soccer. What position?
I played actually two main positions. I was a central defender back in high school, and then in college I moved to playing striker.
Okay. So listen, if Toronto FC needs a player, you ready to go?
I'm ready to go. I've been trying to get on there, but I actually played a couple of years ago in the Masters League, apparently for persons over 40. I understand they told me I was too old, so if they call, I'm ready to go.
All right, so here it is. Ready? It's Easter. It's Easter Sunday. Right? Yes. What's the go-to dish you're going to make for breakfast?
Easter Sunday, the go-to dish is always a fried dumpling and ackee and saltfish.
Okay.
That's the breakfast. That's for breakfast.
Well, what makes your dumpling different than everybody else's dumplings?
I say it's part of it is my special ingredient that I won't share with everybody, so I don't want to get that copyrighted. So, but I've been told by my kids, don't want to embarrass my wife that my dumpling tastes the best. So I'm just gonna stick to the secret ingredients.
All right, so listen, we're gonna take a quick break, but when we come back, I'll for my audience, I'll get your address so we can put it out there. So Easter Sunday, we'll all come over and grab some dumplings so we know whose house to go to for those dumplings.
There you go, there you go.
Stay tuned, we'll be right back.
Today's podcast is brought to you by Beauty Club Outlet. Our goal is to have our clients leave Beauty Club Outlet's store more confident, comfortable, and psychologically liberated than before they came in. And this is the motivation for our entire customer experience and product offering at Beauty Club Outlet. Click the link below and use promo code CMJ for 15% off. Now back to Charles and his special guest.
Call on me, brother, when you need a hand. We all need somebody to lean on.
Yes, we are back with my special guest, and it's a special series I'm doing. I'm interviewing 100 men just to get to know them more. And right now, my special guest is Michael, and he's here talking to us about family life and, doing things for the community. And then just before the break, we talked about his dumplings, his fried Jamaican dumplings, and he has a. I'm trying to get the special ingredient out, but he's holding it tight. So we're gonna have to work on him on that one, my friend.
There you go.
So here it is. As a son, I want to ask you this question. With the things that are going on in our society right now with COVID and all the marching that we're doing, what's the one thing that you say to your son that you whisper in his ear?
Charles, one of the good things is that my son, when I get home from when I get home from work, actually, he's one of the first ones to run and say, "Dad, welcome." And I think I've taught him that when I come in from work, not to run and approach me, but he gives me, the bump, the fist bump, because he
Right.
knows we got to stay our distance. But what I tell him, because he knows about COVID, we talk about it as 4 years old, this guy is versed in all the terminologies. I talk to him about it. I say, you know what? It's not safe right now to, hug dad when he gets home from work or anybody else, off the street or his friends, because there's a pandemic going on, and people can get ill and die. And so his concept is like, when someone dies, do they wake up later on? And I'm like, no, they don't wake up at all. So he's getting that, and he's like, well, I don't want to die, and I don't want anybody else to die. So he gets the concept of, someone dying, and he takes that serious. And I love that. And so I try to instill in him that, it's not that you want to be fearful of anyone, but you want to protect yourself and you want to protect others. And so I think he has that down pat. And I love that he can understand that right now and grasp that at a 4-year-old. And that it gives me hope that when things like this, if they happen again, then he has this frame of mind of understanding that he can understand that and live. And so even right now, he goes to his nana before the pandemic, and because of that, he's not able to go because she's older, of course, and that age range that is critical. And so he understand. But sometime he said, I miss my nana. I miss going to nana. And what he does is like he said, can I call her? And so he calls and he talks with her, and he said, I want to be able to go to my nana and hug my nana and kiss my nana. And but he said, but I understand that I can't do that right now. And so that with him, with me, I'm like, I'm glad that you understand that James, his name, and I'm hoping this will change soon. But he's understanding. It's hard for him, but he's getting it. And, we'll try and make it as easy as possible for him. So I love that.
Yeah, kids are resilient. We thought, they don't understand that, we have to teach them everything, but with what's going on in our world, they see a lot. and they hear things, they see things on social media. So as a father for your sons, for your son and your daughters, how do you keep them from not going too far right and too far left? You know, they see pictures all the time. They hear on social media all the time. They're seeing all the bad things on the news. As a father, what do you do to say, hey, it's okay, this is what we need to do?
Well, I mean, we have our family discussions on a regular basis at family dinners, most times on a Saturday or a Sunday, and we talk about it. But we limit their exposure to the news in terms of, you know, watching it constantly. And so right now they'll watch their, you know, shows and on TV or, you know, the recordings or YouTube. And so we kind of keep them from that, to kind of shield them a bit from it. You know, they do understand. But I'm glad that the older girls, they're there with him, so they'll play games with him. You know, we have a Wii. You know, I know everybody's move on, but he loves his Wii, and he plays with them, Nintendo Switch to play. What we have done in our backyard, we have actually bought a trampoline. We have bought an inflatable pool. And so that's kind of their getaway. So they go outside, get some exercise on trampoline, get in the pool. You know, my middle daughter, she loves to swim, so she's out there as many times as she can. My older daughter, she go on bike rides and, you know, take her mask with her. And so we try and get them in a different routine because they can't go out as often as we used to before the pandemic. So that's why I try and instill on them and say, you know what, we're here as a family. This is an opportunity for us to get to know each other more because we're going to spend more time with each other. And sometimes it's hard because I can see it in their reaction. Sometimes they're kind of, I will say, tired of each other because they're with each other every day. So I think one time my son told my middle daughter, like, you know what, you know, can you just leave me for a minute? I just want my time. You want my space. So I said to her, well, you got to, you know, give him his space, you know, give him his time. And so, you know, one would go downstairs, watch TV, another one would go upstairs, watch TV. And so that separation is vital because, you know, when you're with somebody every day, sometimes you get tired and you want your little space. So as a four-year-old, my son recognizes that, tells the middle one, and she, okay, I'll give you your space. And so it's important to create a different routine with them. And my wife, when she gets home from work, she will go over their schoolwork with them. And I get home and, you know, allow them to go outside of the front, play basketball. So we have a different routine now because of that. But I know it's hard for them trying to stay away from friends and other family members. But that's what we have to do to get through this. You know, we're saving everybody.
So here it is. You know, we talked about it, and it says, you know, on your title, former city council candidate. If you run again, if you decide to jump on this wagon again, and people hear now that, you know, they hear that you as a father, they hear you as, you know, a business person, they hear that you love, you're passionate. When you go knocking on the doors, what do you want people to know about you when they open the door?
The first thing I want them to know about me is that once I set out to complete a task, I will not give up until it's completed. So as I said, I am driven. If you know, when I run initially, there was an issue in our community, still is, with crime. You know, high crime rate, and so I'm going to fight for that. And right now, we are fighting for that to make sure that that, you know, criminals are being arrested first thing and brought to justice. The other thing they want them to know also, Charles, is that I am in the community. You know, I have a family in the community. I have a vested interest in the community to make sure that things that are supposed to be happening in the community are happening. You know, if there's a stop sign that needs to go up at a particular intersection, if we need to restrict movement of vehicle because there are a lot of speeding going on, then we need to do what we can, whether it's speed bumps, whether it's reducing the lanes. So whatever needs to be done, I'm going to make sure it's done so that our community can benefit from it. So those are the two things I'll let people know right away. I am there for the long haul. I'm not just here as a pretty face, as some people say, but I'm here to make sure the job gets done.
Well, listen, I hope that people will listen to this podcast and know a little bit about you now. That was the whole idea of this podcast, is to see, hear you first before we judge you. So I thank you so much for taking the time to come on my show, my friend.
Thank you, Charles. Thank you for having me, and I appreciate being here. And anytime, you know, we support each other because we're in this together.
All right. But before we let you go, we do one thing here. It's called the shout out. This is your opportunity to say hi to anybody out there that's listening live or will be listening to later. This is your opportunity to shout them out.
Thank you. Well, I want to shout out my wife, Denise. You know, she compliments me. She, you know, she pushes me. She gives me the drive also. We're kind of like, you know, sometimes oil and water, but you know what? We get the best out of each other. And I was going to shout out to my wife, Denise. I love you. And, you know, my love will never fail. And thank you for supporting me.
All right. Thank you, my friend. You've been a great guest.
Thank you, Charles, and we'll talk soon.
All right, everybody. That's guest number two of a series of my brothers, 100 men, talking to them. Let's get to know them. We'll see you later.
It's come to an end, but the fun doesn't have to stop here. If you have any questions, suggestions, or feedback, head over right now to Twitter and Facebook and like, share, and get involved. Join us next time.
Please be advised that this podcast is meant for educational and informational purposes only and is in no way a replacement for legal or medical advice. The opinions contained within are solely those of the interviewers and interviewees and should be received as so. Those seeking help or advice are encouraged to obtain professional legal and medical services.